Welcome back into Ray and B. Dillard Field here at Ashmore Park as we get set for game two of the day between the North Greenville Crusaders and the Lenoir-Rhyne Bears. Here's the lineup for North Greenville here in a game that they have to have or their season will come to an end today. Same lineup. There's only one change from the starting lineup from game one. Leading batting off will be Garrick Octavio, Ethan Stringer, then Pat Monteith, Marek Kloop, Josh Center, Zach Zara. Campbell Connard goes behind the plate. Bryce Roddy, who came in for Jordan Holliday as a DH in game one, he gets to start as a DH here in game two. And then Corey Bivens, of course, in the nine slot. Get a look at the Lenoir-Rhyne defensive alignment. Same as the previous two games here in the Tigerville Regional. In the outfield from left to right, Bryce Stober, Wade Kuda, David Bell. On the infield from left to right, Eric Ramirez, Luis Atiles, Koloskowski, Anthony Perino, and then Nick Clarino behind the plate. And on the mound for Lenoir-Rhyne is Austin Edwards. He's getting a look at his numbers right there. This is his 14th start of the year. 5-1 record, 3.47 ERA, 59 and two-thirds innings pitch, 43 hits, 30 runs, 23 of which were earned, 20 walks, 77 strikeouts. Opponents only batting 198 off Mr. Ryan Edwards. Austin Edwards, excuse me. In the first two games for Lenoir-Rhyne of this Tigerville Regional, they've gotten a lot of depth from their starting pitchers. One going eight innings, the other one going seven innings. See if they can continue that tread here with Mr. Edwards as Gary Octavi stands in. And the first pitch called strike. First pitch at 3:59 Eastern Standard Time. Temperature currently at 91 degrees here in Tigerville, South Carolina. 0-1. Just a tad bit high. Again, your umpires for game two today. Behind the plate is Bobby Dunnigan. Over first base, Casey Smith. Julius Green out second. Then Kevin Spivey over there at third. One from Edwards. What's that one past Octavio? 1-2. So if Lenoir-Rhyne wins, they win the regional, they eliminate North Greenville, and they will move on to the Super Regional next weekend where they will await the winner of the Wingate Regional. Here's the 1-2. That slapped out of play. If North Greenville were to win, we'd come back here tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock for the deciding game three. They were still ahead of Octavio, 1-2. Pitch. Breaking ball just got a piece of that, did Garrick. And good pitching beats good hitting, and that's exactly what we got in game one as Sir Andrew Patrick shut things down for Lenoir-Rhyne. That one's out to left field, coming in. It is Stober to make the catch, one away. There's Ethan Stringer. First pitch to Ethan is inside. Stringer went 0-4 in the first game today. He does have one hit in the regional. It was yesterday against Pembroke. One out. Pitch on the outside corner, even to count up. Stringer batting 302 coming into game two today. Because Bunn gets it down third base, that's going to be a tough play. Edwards, it's a little bit low throw, and it's not going to be in time. So a hit for Ethan Stringer comes via the bunt. North Greenville will take it any way they can get it. Bring up third baseman Pat Monteith. Monteith had four hits in the win last night. He didn't have the same luck earlier today. He went 0 for 3. First pitch to Monteith is painted on the outside corner, knee high, 0-1. Monteith batting 343 coming into action. The 0-1 to him is sent out to right field. Going back is Bell, but he's stopping on the warning track just in front of the wall to make the grab, two away. Monteith gave a little bit of a ride, just didn't quite have enough to get it out of here. So here's Marek Klup. Klup batting 419 on the year, 12 home runs and 69 runs batted in. Klup was 1-for-4 in game two earlier today. He's first pitch swinging as fouls that one back. The 0-1 from Edwards. Swing away at that one. Fouls that one over the North Greenville dugout. And starting pitching. The big time story for Lenoir-Rhyne. I mean, through the first 18 innings of the regionals, the starters have carried them through the 15 of those 18. Lanham with his start yesterday going 8 innings, and then Patrick going 7 innings earlier today. As Klup hits that one in left field, that's going to have enough to get down. Stringer around second. He's on his way to third. He's going to get there. And North Greenville's got runners on the corners and two down. Already two hits for the Crusaders early on. Took them 5 innings to get to the 2-hit mark in game one earlier today, so a little bit better start from the offense. Here's a guy that's due. He's been outstanding with his glove work in the field here in this regional. His last plate appearance in game one in the 8th inning, he had a double, so maybe that'll get him off the snide a little bit. That's his first hit of the regional. Klup over at first has 25 for 27 in terms of stolen bases. Would be surprised to not see it going at some point in this at bat. That one's fouled back. Here's the 0-1. Oh, before that, we're going to get a check on Klup. For update, an elimination game over at Wingate. Belmont Abbey currently leads Young Harris 3-0 in the top half of the 5th inning. Columbus State and Wingate, a high-profile matchup that'll take place later tonight at 7 o'clock. Klup not going as the breaking ball didn't quite break back far enough to be a strike. Count even at 1-1. Count even at 1-1 to the North Greenville center fielder. Fielder. There, Kloops takes off for second. That one's ripped and over the head of the shortstop and into left field for a base hit. Kloops on his way to third. They're going to wave him around third. They ran through the stop sign. Throw's going to be up the line. He's going to get away from everybody, go all the way to the backstop. Sitting around second. He goes about halfway to third, puts on the brakes and heads back to second, and North Greenville takes the 2-0 lead. Imperative for North Greenville to try to jump out, try to get something going. Only scored one run in the entire 9-inning game they played earlier. They already got two here. They take the 2-0 lead. So here's Zach Zara. The majority of the damage coming with two outs. Zara showed bunt, but pulls it back. Tavia flew out to left. Stringer reached on a bunt single. Monty flew out on the warning track in right field. Two outs, one runner on first, and with Kloop and then center. Both singled, and that one's up the middle. That's going to get through for a base hit. Center can fly. They're going to wave him around third. Throw will come into second, and North Greenville leads it 3-0. Good piece of hitting by Zach Zara. Three runs on four hits already for the Crusaders.
Now batting number 17, Campbell Connard.
Here's Campbell Connard. One of those foul back. And the entire game, North Greenville only had five hits. They already have four hits, and we're not even out of the first inning yet. They've been allowing teams to jump on them in the first inning. They thought it was about time they jumped on somebody. Here's the 0-1 to Campbell. It's a good pitch that time there from Edwards, 0-2. Connor, the seventh North Greenville hitter to hit in the inning. Very close that time, just missed outside. Umpire Bob Dunn again behind the plate confirming that it was outside. The count's at 1-2. Connor at catcher day in place of Jax Cash. The 1-2 is a breaking ball. Ooh, I don't know where that one missed. Looked like a good breaking ball from up here from Edwards. But nonetheless, count even at 2-2. Nice stop there by Clarno to keep that one in front of him. So from 0-2 to 3-2. Bryce Roddy waits on deck. The 3-2. Swung on and miss. Connor goes down on strikes, but not before North Greenville responds in a big way. They know they need to have this game. They pick up three runs on four hits. We played half an inning. North Greenville 3. Lenoir-Rhyne coming to bat. 3-0 North Greenville as we head to the bottom of the first. Here's the starting lineup for the Bears of LR. Same lineup they've trotted out there the first two games of this regional. Be David Bell, Cole Laskowski, Drew Yanesta, Nick Clarino, Luisa Teles, Anthony Perino, Wade Kuda, Bryce Stober, and then Eric Ramirez. Here's the defensive alignment for North Greenville. Ethan Stringer in left, Josh Center in center, Marek Kloop in right. On the infield left to right will be Pat Monteith, Corey Bivens, Garrett Octavio, Zach Zarr over at first. Campbell Connor gets the start behind the plate in place of Jax Cash. And on the mound for the Crusaders, right-hander Noah Takis. Get a look of him right there. Press the VRA for him. It's only his third official start of the year. He has been used as kind of like the starting pitcher for an opener. Like the Crusaders will use an opener for him, and then he'll come in and pitch the innings 2 through 6, 2 through 7. Times he's been on a pitch count this year, his official numbers, it's his third start. Win-loss record of 5-0, 1.7 ERA, 47 and two-thirds innings pitch. 22 hits, 11 runs, 9 of which earned, 18 walks, and 37 strikeouts. Opponents batting only .138 off right-hand pitcher Noah Takis. Got his hands full with this red-hot Bears offense. As leadoff man, David Bell will make his way to the plate. Bell was 1-for-4 in game one. He also had an RBI sacrifice fly. Takis has been a little bit the hot hand for North Greenville as his first pitch to Bell is a slider cut on and missed. He got the start in a winner's bracket game against Mount Olive in the conference tournament. Pitched one of the best performances of the year from a North Greenville starter. Same exact pitch, same exact result there, 0-2. Definitely the biggest start of the year for Takis with this team season on the line. Here's the 0-2, little quick pitch. That was lofted out towards left field. Stringer calling off center. It'll make the grab, one away. And the key right now for Noah Takis and this North Greenville pitching staff, these first two games they've gotten off to rotten starts. Be blunt here. Gave up 4 runs to UNC Pembroke. Fortunately for them, that was all they gave up, and they were able to come back and score 6 times to win. Game earlier today, they gave up 2 runs to this LR team. Kind of put them behind the 8-ball, and they were never really able to recover. That was all Andrew Patrick needed. First pitch to Laskowski, misses low and in. Putting the shift on. Bivens shaded a little bit closer towards the second base bag. Tavio out there in short right center field, as he normally does. The 1-0. Beautiful breaking ball, even to count up. Wind starting to pick up, blowing from left to right as 1-1's fouled off of the plate. In same conditions, basically, as we've had since noon yesterday of the first game. Wind sitting steady, I'd say about between 6 to 8 miles per hour. We're around 90 degrees. A quick pitch from Takis, that one's poked, but right at Monteith, and there's 2 away. Now we'll bring up the DH, number 23, Drew Yanesta. Yanesta was officially 1-for-5 in game one earlier today. Comes in batting .385. You see those 14 home runs. He's capable of leaving the yard at any moment. He did so yesterday against the Braves of UNC Pembroke. First pitch to him. Chopped on the ground, third base side. Monteith will field it on a hop, throw across the diamond in time, and it's a quick 1-2-3 inning for Noah Takis and the North Greenville defense. We played one inning here in Tigerville, South Carolina. Elimination game for the Crusaders. We head to the top of the second, 3-0. So it'll be 8-9-1, two up for North Greenville here in the top of the second. Game they have to have in order to force a decisive game three tomorrow. It'll be Bryce Roddy, Corey Bivens, and it'll be back to the top of the order for Garrett Octavio. Bryce Roddy batting 379. This is just his third start of the year. Took a hack at that one, came up empty 0-1. Where shows bunt, tries to push it third base side, but can't keep it fair. Was trying to get his second strike out of the ball game as the 0-2 to put in play is going to be right to Edwards. He'll underhand it to first for the first out of the inning. So here's Corey Bivens. Bivens is one of the few North Greenville hitters that actually had a good offensive showing in game number one today. He had two hits, two of the five hits that North Greenville had. The 1-0 from Edwards. Check swing. They're going to peel down to first. He did not go around. Be careful here to Bivens. He does have 10 home runs on the air, so he does have the capability to send one out of here. Here's the 2-0. Not close, 3-0. If you're a right-handed batter and you pull one today, it's going to be a tough ask. As I mentioned earlier, wind blowing from left to right. Occasionally it'll kind of make its way towards in from right center, but mostly blowing from left field towards right. 3-0. Right down the middle, 3-1. So definitely be a poke, but you can definitely get it out to left field. But the way the ball has been carrying this weekend, best bet to try to hit one to right. Here's the 3-1. Guys do just that as that one's hit out in the right center field. Going back toward a wall. What I just say, out towards right center field. Corey Bivens with a solo blast, his 11th of the year. North Greenville out on top, 4-0. Bivens, that's RBI number 47 for him on the campaign. That puts us back to the top of the order for Garrick Octavio. In the first inning, he flew out to left. First home run hit today. Two teams that definitely know how to leave the yard. Out about showing bunt, but pulled it back. And a long way to go in this one. Here's the 1-0. Pitch paints the outside corner. This LR offense very capable of putting up crooked numbers, and this North Greenville team knows that they are going to need to get as many runs as they can. It's another similar pitch on the outside corner, makes it 1-2. Breaking ball didn't quite get on top of that one. Count even at 2-2. Tigerville looking to kind of break out of a little bit of a slump he's had. He's still looking for his first hit of the regional. Here's the 2-2. Way outside, running full. Ethan Stringer waits on deck. Here's the payoff pitch. Breaking ball. That's out in the left center field. That's going to be trouble. That's going to get down. Nice play, though, from Kuda to keep that one from going behind him. So he gets that one in quick. Gets away, but not enough for Octavio to advance. That's his first hit of the regional. Already the 6th for North Greenville. Oh, it appears Wade Kuda might be down out there in left center field. Oh, man, does not look good out there. I'm not sure exactly what happened. He tried to get the ball back in quick after Octavio hit that in the left center field. Whatever it is, something happened. I don't know. It definitely looks like a lower leg injury. And you hate to see this. I don't know if we got a replay. I don't know if we even want to see the replay on that one, but I just saw he did a fantastic job of cutting that ball off, because in fact he was able to hold the speedy Octavio over at first. It was impressive to say the least. While they tend to him, we'll step aside. We'll take the replay. We'll see what happened here. Dude, athlete play just to keep down. Oh, a little. Maybe that's an ankle. That did not look good. It's like a little turf monster got him on that one. You can see, I don't know if you saw it on that replay, if you can go back. His foot kind of turned it whenever he came down. He made, like I said, made a great play to keep that one from going in the gap and bouncing over him. Tough to see out there, but it looks like he's at least to his feet now. And Wade Kuda, the center fielder, big part of this Lenoir-Rhyne offense, leads the team with 16 home runs on the year. Be a huge blow if he can't go. Okay, well, it looks like the coach and the trainer are going to retreat, and Cuda's going to stay out there. Well, that's a good sign. It didn't, I don't know if you saw on the replay, still kind of bent over a little bit, but definitely took a misstep out there. The turf monster got him a little bit. But I'm glad to see he's going to stay in the game. Big part of this LR offense for sure. Definitely still feeling the pain out there for sure. Nonetheless, glad to see he's okay and he's able to stay in the game. That could have turned out a lot worse than it did. So here's Ethan Stringer. About a 2.5-3 stride lead over there at first. They're going to check on him. North Greenville up 4-0 here in the top of the second. 3 runs in the top of the first. Then opposite field shot by Corey Bivens with 1 out. Here comes with a breaking ball. Paints it on the outside corner. Good pitch. Stringer has one of the 6 base hit for the Crusaders so far. So he laid down a perfect bunt. Another breaking ball in there. That's a beauty. 0-2. Plenty of pitches for Edwards to work with here. See if he comes with another breaking ball. Skip that one up there. Nice stop there by Clarence behind the plate. I feel like I've said that multiple times this weekend. Kid's been a brick wall back behind the plate. Another check on Octavio over there at first. Garrick has 18 stolen bases on the year and 24 tries. There goes Octavio as the pitch is inside. Throw down to second will be late. So Octavio steals his 19th bag of the year, and he's in scoring position. Counts at 2-2 to Stringer. Here's the 2-2. Paints a fastball on the outer half. Strike 3. Stringer may have been looking for a breaking ball, but he got fastball instead, and that's the second strikeout for Austin Edwards. Here's Pat Monteith. Monteith just missed a home run his last time up, flew out to the warning track in right field. First pitch to him is a breaking ball in the outer half. And if Pat can hit one out in the left center field, he could run for a while. That one's outside. As you can see, you get a... Just saw Wade Cuna. Kind of shaded towards right center field. His camera's kind of positioned out there in right center field, and that's how far he's kind of shaded over. left fielder playing out there by the scoreboard. So if there's he split the gap in the left center field, he could run for a while. As that one is popped up. That may be in no man's land. Who wants it? Right fielder coming in. Just foul territory. Can't make the grab. That was really, really close to the foul line, but he was just creeping into foul territory when couldn't quite make the squeeze. It counts at 1-2 as Monteith gets another chance. And four runs on six hits for the Crusaders. Was trying to get us to the bottom of the second. Here's the 1-2. Breaking ball got. Pat the wave over the top of that one. Third strikeout for Edwards, but not before Corey Bivens gives North Greenville a fourth insurance run as he blasts his 11th home run the opposite way to right center field. Go to the bottom of the second. 4-0 Crusaders. Four, five, and six do up for the Bears here in the bottom of the second as they trail 4-0. Beatiles, Perino, they will follow Clairno. First pitch from Takis is a breaking ball that stayed high. Catches the outer half. Takis with that kind of short stride. He doesn't go with the full-on leg kick out of the windup. Kind of just a abrupt stride towards the plate. With a little Johnny Cueto-esque as that one's nub foul. Sometimes he'll hit you with the short stride. Sometimes he'll hit you with the holding the leg kick. Sometimes he'll just do a normal stride. It kind of mixes it up. Tries to throw off the timing of these LR hitters. The 1-2. On the ground to second. Tavia fills it. Throw over to first. It'll be in time. One away. Four up, four down. Four Takis to start the ball game. So here's Atiles. Tellez was 0 for 4 in game one earlier today. First pitch to him is fastball on the inside corner. Lenoir-Rhyne trying to punch their ticket to their first Super Regional. North Greenville trying to stave off elimination, force a game three tomorrow. Here's the 1-1. That's on the ground to short. Bivens will field the two-hopper. Strong throw over first in time, two away. So here's Anthony Perino. Perino was 1 for 4 earlier today. His hit coming in the eighth inning of game one. Comes into the day batting 382. 12 bombs go along with a 63 runs batted in. He's first pitch swinging out on the right. Getting ball carrying out there. Kloop's going to get up on it because it is gone. Solo jack for Anthony Perino. That's home run number 13 on the air. RBI number 64. And it's 4-1. Something about going the opposite way to right field here. As the trend continues. So a two-out solo shot by Anthony Perino. That'll bring up Let's not wait, Kuda. So it is in just a second. Actually, number 14, Ethan Smith. Appears they're going to take down Wade Kuda after his injury a half inning ago.
Now batting number 14, Ethan Smith.
0-1 breaking ball stayed outside. Smith, the sophomore of Mickenville, Tennessee, Warren County High School. It appears it was just injury was just too much for Kuda to handle, so they're just kind of being precautious with him. As the 1-1's cut on and missed. Now with two strikes, North Greenville defense will put the shift on. Three infielders on the right side. Monteith over playing the shortstop position, the lone defender on the left side of the infield. For the 1-2, time's called. Here's the 1-2. Ball just got a piece of that one. Cued that one foul. One, two, skips up there. Even the count up at 2-2. Ethan batting 143 on the year. No home runs, no runs batted in. Just joining us, Wade Kuda suffered an injury a half inning ago. He stayed in, played the rest of the inning, but being taken down here for a pitch hitter. Here's the 2-2. Beautiful breaking ball on the outside corner for strike three. First strikeout for Takis here this afternoon. Well, Lenoir-Rhyne gets one back on the opposite field solo shot by Anthony Perino. We head to the top of the third, 4-1 North Greenville. 4, 5, and 6 do it for the Crusaders here in the top of the third. It's a first pitch breaking ball, doesn't get the call. And breaking ball's at the top of the zone. Bobby Dunnigan behind the plate hasn't been given the call. Here's the 1-0. That one's about a 58-footer. Didn't really count here for Kloop as he's hacking him, fouls it away. Austin Edwards out there for his third inning of work. He's given up four runs thus far. Another breaking ball at the top of the zone, doesn't get the call, 3-1. One to Kloop. Him the slider that time. Count runs full. Mark had one of those base hits in the first inning for North Greenville that brought home a run. Him with a breaking ball that time, missed away. It's a leadoff walk for Kloop as that'll bring up Josh Center. And if you're LR, that's last thing you want, because Kloop leads the team that likes to steal a lot. He's 25 for 27 on the air. Actually had his second caught stealing of the year last night against UNC Pembroke as he was on third base, broke for home, thinking the ball was further away. Tried to score and was nabbed at the plate. Not going this time as that one's low. Center also followed up Mark Kloop's base hit in the first with a base hit of his own that brought home a couple of North Greenville runs. There goes Kloop as he takes off for second. Throw low as the throw down to second will be late. Kloop with his 26th stolen bag of the year. He's in scoring position. Count it 2-0 again. Well, wardrobe malfunction with the piece in his ear that in which he receives a sign from his coach, and they walkie it in. A pitch they want to throw. And here friendly count here for center. The 2-0. He's hacking, pops it up. First base side. Perino giving chase, but it'll be out of play. There were kids nearby in the area. Thankfully, they weren't close enough. Count it 2-1. To this point, four runs on six hits, no errors for North Greenville. One run, one hit, one error for the Bears. Of Lenoir-Rhyne. Here's the 2-1. That one's fouled back over the net. And there's a gap out there in left center field. He's got a little bit of room out there down the left field line if he can fit one down there. 2-2 from Edwards. It's a fastball just off the black. Yeah. That was a great pitch that time there from Edwards. Center just didn't bite on it. So the count runs full. Here's the 3-2. Beautiful breaking ball, full center, and he knew it. Well executed pitch there from Edwards. That's his fourth strikeout of the ball game. And that'll bring up Zach Zara. You know, the beloved number 99. Not the number you see every day. Kloop out there at second. He walked to begin the inning. Later stole second. Sorry, it wasn't really a key piece in the lineup for a little while. Yeah, this is only his 17th start of the year. That's the first pitch to him is off the plate. But with some injuries, you know, Jordan Holliday, who had been kind of occupying the first base slash DH role, kind of hitting a little bit of a slump here recently, so he hadn't been in the lineup as often as he was to begin the year. It kind of changed for him when he injured his hip flexor. And then, of course, the injury to John Michael fails. He unravels some things for the Crusaders as big swing from Czar comes up empty. Anytime you lose your All-American catcher and widely considered, if not the best hitter in all Division II, John Michael Fale, led the country in RBIs with 81 before he went down in the conference tournament. Again, could possibly return for the College World Series or should North Greenville get there, but a long way to go. So that one's on the ground, first base side. Nice stop there by Perino. Underhand to the covering Edwards for out number two. Moving to third is Kloop. So here's Campbell Connor. He struck out swinging to end the first. Both teams enter game two today with 46 wins on the year. Both tied with each other for second in the nation. The only team that's better right now is Wingate, who's at 47. Beautiful backdoor breaking ball to Connor. Puts it 0-1. Again, keep reiterating that most years, Lenoir-Rhyne would have been good enough to be a top two seed in the Southeast region, but just a lot of loaded teams, you know, North Greenville, Wingate, defending national champions, Columbus State, of course, as well. That one's through the left side. That's going to get through for a base hit. Kloop will score. As North Greenville gets that run right back, it's 5-1. Connor, that's his seventh RBI of the year. Here's Bryce Roddy. Beautiful piece of hitting there from Campbell Connor. Just got a pitch in the outer half, didn't try to do too much with it, just kind of guided it through the left side through that 5-6 hole. First pitch to Ronnie's a fastball off the plate. Connor over there first. No offense to him, but you know he's only got about a stride lead over there. Coming with that so-called catcher speed. And his first pitch to Ronnie is a nice stop there by Clarino again. Ronnie's 0-1. He grounded out back to the pitcher, back to Edwards. His first time up. First pitch to him, excuse me, the 1-0 pitch to him. Swung right through that one, 1-1. Correction, 1-2. Mm-hmm. pitch. That's inside. 3-1. Look for one spot here if you're Connor. Edwards maybe trying to see if he can get him to swing at something. He maybe wouldn't. Hits that one out to right field, but got it off the end of the bat as Bell started back, but now coming in a step or two, makes the catch for the third and final out. But not before North Greenville picks up a run. Thanks in large part to the two-out base hit by Campbell Connor. We go to the bottom of the third, North Greenville out in front, 5-1. Eight, 9-1, do it for the Bears here in the bottom of the third. It'll be Stober, Ramirez, and then Bell. Take us out for his third inning of work. It's his first pitch to Stober is a breaking ball. 0-1. Still 3-0 Belmont Abbey over Young Harris, an elimination game over in the Wingate Regional. That one's on the ground to short. Bevin's going to have to come in, throw on the run in time to get the speedy Stober, one away. Of course, a highly anticipated matchup also going down tonight over there in Wingate, North Carolina. It'll be the number 3 seed. Number 9 nationally ranked Columbus State. They'll be taking on the host Wingate. That should be a fun one. Got a fun one here as well between North Greenville and Lenoir-Rhyne. As Texas' first pitch to Ramirez is a beautiful fastball painted on the black. 0-1. Tagus goes with a short stride this time in the windup and fouled away quickly. 0-2. He's definitely utilizing that so far early on, especially the first time through the order. Be interesting to see how his LR offense does a second time through as Bell waits on deck. It's hit on the ground. Another one to Corey Bivens over there, short. A little high throw, but he came off the bag. Right. Zara says he looked like he said, I stayed on. Rand Powell immediately is going to come out and ask home plate and first base umpire to kind of converge here. Take another look at that. The high throw. Ooh. That was close. Well, if you can show that again, maybe. You try to get another look at that one as the umpires converge. It was a high throw from the shortstop, Bivens. Here we go. It looks like it was, which foot was it? Yeah, see, foot comes down. It was tough to tell if it was on the bag. If it was on the bag, he's definitely out. And Zara seemed to think that he was like, yeah, I came right down on it. Actually going to go over to the Chris Ramirez over there at third base. I mean, it looked like his foot came down on the bag. First base umpire for this game is Casey Smith. He made the call saying that Zara did not come down on the bag. I mean, if that foot came down on the bag, which it looked like it did, it looks like they're going to call him out. And we don't have advantage of the umpires getting to see the replay, but ultimately it appears that they are going to get it right. And it was tough to see where exactly that foot was, but it definitely looked like, appeared that the foot came down on the bag. It was definitely in time. It was just only a matter of whether his foot came down on the bag or not. So here's David Bell as the Bears begin their second trip through the lineup. A little quick pitch again. Okay, putting the shift on for Bell. Three defenders on the left side of the infield. Check swing. He did go around, says home plate umpire Bobby Dunnigan, 1-2. One of those your LR, you just love to see him kind of go against that shift and maybe hit like a 15 hopper out there. That would have been a routine ground ball to second, try to get him a base hit. That one skips up there. Two's across the board. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Here's the pitch. Great ball and chop third base side, but foul. His hands over there by Coach Ramirez. Here's the 2-2. Again, foul third base side. It was a good shot we had there. Kind of Bell's a little bit closer towards the pitcher in the batter's box. Going with that approach, maybe to try to throw something off and get a shot right there. It's like right on the line of that batter's box too as well. The 2-2, ground third base side. Monteith bobbles it, and Bell's going to be safe at first. So that'll be an E5. First error of the game for the Crusaders. That'll extend the inning for Koloskowski. Kowski's 0-1. couldn't quite beat the shift. Tried to go the other way to beat the shift, but it just happened to be right at Monteith, who was the lone defender on the left side of the infield. First pitch to Laskowski is inside and almost hit him. Interesting thing with Laskowski, he's actually looking for his first hit of the regional, but he's been on base five times. He's walked twice, and he's been hit by a pitch three times. One of backdoor breaking ball is a called strike. Interesting. I wonder what's going through Tax's mind. I've always wondered. He kind of looks like he's checking the runner back at second, even though there's nobody on second. See if he does it here. He kind of looks back at second. There's nobody out there. So have to talk to coaches about that, see what that's about. Maybe it's just an instinct thing. Maybe that's something he's just used to doing. Counts 1-2. Tags one strike away from sending us to the fourth inning. There's 1-2 as Gold takes off for second. It's a check swing strike. So throw down to second won't matter as Laskowski's retired on strikes. That's the second strikeout of the ball game for Tackus, and he's through three innings. And North Greenville keeps their lead right where it's at, 5-1 as we head to the fourth. So we head to the fourth inning. North Greenville on top 5-1. It'll be 9-1-2 duo for the Crusaders. Bivens is 1-for-1. He launched his 11th home run of the year back in the second. Opposite field shot gave the Crusaders a 4-0 lead at the time. We currently stand 5-1. First pitch breaking ball from Edwards broke too far, 1-0. Back with a good pitch that time, evens the count up at 1-1. The story for LR has been their starting pitching, especially the first two games. Getting 15 innings out of their starting pitchers, both of which throwing over 100 pitches. 1-1 breaking ball's cut on and missed. Look at Edwards' numbers coming in. I mean, 5-1 on the year, solid 3.47 ERA. North Greenville's just gotten back to their ways here in game number two. That one's popped up. Who wants it? It's going to be the left fielder Stober, as that one finally comes down. It was up there for a long time. One away. To finish that thought, yeah. Andrew Patrick just absolutely shoved for seven innings earlier today for the Lenoir-Rhyne Bears today. I mean, it's completely held this North Greenville team down. I mean, they had five hits the entire ball game. I mean, as of right now, we're in the fourth. They have seven. Just kind of confirms that the heck of a job Mr. Andrew Patrick did earlier today. That one's right there, strike one. The 0-1 to Octavio's a backdoor breaking ball. Quickly head 0-2. Octavio's 1-for-2 today. He got his first hit of the regional back in the second. He's also flown out to left. The 0-2. Not close. Count at 1-2. Skips that one up there. Count even at 2-2. Octavio. Nicknamed the Flying Hawaiian from Hilo, Hawaii, transferred from Murray State College, an NAIA school out there in Oklahoma. As the 2-2. On the ground is short. Tila's got the charge. Throw on the run. Close play, but they got him. Two up, two down for the Bears here in the top of the fourth. The final hope for the Crusaders will be Ethan Stringer. Stringer's 1-for-2. His base hit coming in the first. That was a bunt single. Takes a first pitch fastball on the outside corner. Stringer, two hits in the regional. Had one hit against UNC Pembroke last night. His bunt single in the first was his second. Edwards is a breaking ball, and it's a beauty, 0-2. Definitely knows when Edwards works ahead in a count to these North Greenville hitters, he can be extremely tough. Only when you fall behind is when he gets in a little bit of trouble. But he's ahead of Stringer, 0-2. Here's the pitch. Poked through the glove of Edwards. Tough throw on the run. It's a little high. Appears the throw has gone out of play, so that means Stringer will make his way down to second base. So they'll give him a hit, and then he'll go to second on the throw. So that'll go down as an E4 on that one. It's the eighth hit of the ball game for the Crusaders. Second error as well for Lenoir-Rhyne. Let's be clear, they gave him the hit. That's his third of the regional, second of the game. Here's Pat Monteith. He gets the first pitch breaking ball in the outer half, 0-1. Monteith still looking for his first hit today. He went 0-4 in game one today, and he's currently 0-2. He's flown out to deep right, and he also struck out swinging in the second. 0-1 is in the turf. Nice stop by Clarino. Monteith with that slightly open stance to start with. Kid's got a lot of pop. He was the freshman of the year in Conference Carolinas a year ago. He improved upon that this year as he gets a breaking ball, and it's a beauty. Edwards ahead of Monteith, 1-2. 1-2 from Edwards. In the turf. Two's across the board, two balls, two strikes, two outs. Runner on second. Here's the 2-2. Got him a chase, a breaking ball in the outer half. Good breaking ball that time there from Edwards, and they will leave Stringer stranded at second. Go to the bottom of the fourth. Lenoir-Rhyne got some work to do. They find themselves trailing 5-1. Three, four, and five do it for the Bears as they find themselves trailing 5-1. They only have one hit thus far, and that was the solo shot by Anthony Perino. As they make their way to the second time through the order against North Greenville starter Noah Takis. And naturally, as they have been, they put the shift on for Unestas. That one's hit out to left field. That's going to bloop and fall in front of Ethan Stringer out there in left for a leadoff single. So here's Nick Clairno. Yeah. Just a second hit for the Bears here in this one. And as it takes off for second, it looks like a hit and run. Bivens will have to field it. Nice pick, but he can't get it out of the glove. And everybody will be safe. So back-to-back hits for the Bears as they have something going here with runners at first and second. Nobody out. Here's the shortstop, Luis Atiles. 0-for-1, grounded out the short his first time. All right, trying to chip away at this North Greenville lead. Tillis showed bunt, like he was going to pull it back. Kind of like what they did in game one earlier today. They had a well-executed slash play that worked out for him. Normally, it would be a routine 6-4-3 double play, but it was Bryce Stober that squared around the bunt and pulled it back and swung the bat and hit about a 15 hopper out there in the left center field. But the problem was Corey Bivens, the shortstop, had already broke towards third as Pat Monteith came charging in. So there was no one there. Bears end up picking up a run and adding a couple more of that frame. Here's the 1-1. And with the breaking ball there, 1-2. So Attagas comes with right here, but before that, we'll get time calling. It was a really long look in. Attagas has been effective with that breaking ball of his today. Also likes to challenge with the fastball from time to time with two strikes. Here's the 1-2. Breaking ball just got a piece of that, did Atiles. Cal remains 1-2. Here's the 1-2. Bring well, that's hit up the middle. Bivens will take it to the second base bag himself. Will throw on to first in time. Six unassisted, three double play. Nice. Nifty footwork there by the North Greenville shortstop. There's a runner on third, now two away. See if we can take another look at that one. That was a thing of beauty there by Corey Bivens. As you get a look at Anthony Perino right there. That one's hit out to right field. Kloop on the run. Can't get there. That one's going to bounce over the fence for a ground rule double. The run does come in to score, and it's 5-2. Especially what could have been for the Bears had Bivens not have made that six unassisted double play. So here's Ethan Smith. Came on in the third inning for the injured Wade Kuda. He could have had that kind of weird injury out there in center field in the top half of the third inning, but when he came back and he stayed out there, played the rest of the half inning out there, but came in and when it was his turn to bat, Ethan Smith grabbed the bat. I guess he wasn't healthy enough to continue. As the first pitch sails way out. Here's the 1-0 from Takis. Got on top of the breaking ball that time, 1-1. Greenville outfield playing Smith very, very shallow out there and all the way across the board, right, center, and left. Breaking ball, that's chopped foul into the Bear dugout. Counts at 1-2. Long, long look in for Takis. Finally gets the pitch that he wants. And 1-2 runner takes off for third. Pitches outside. They'll just let Perino have the third base bag. You know, that's just his third stolen bag of the season. Trying to go after the hitter, Ethan Smith, right here. The 2-2. Sent out right center field. Center says he's got it, and he does to retire the side. Lenoir-Rhyne gets a run back, thanks in part to the ground rule double from Anthony Perino. We head to the fifth, 5-2 North Greenville. It'll be Kloop center and then Zara. Kloop's one for one. He's reached base both times he's come to the plate. Single in the first, later scored, and then he walked to lead off the third. First pitch to him. Good breaking ball from Edwards, who's out there for his fifth inning of work. Here's a one. And with another breaking ball, that's on the outside corner as well, 0-2. Yo, two. Got Kloop to chase one. That's exactly the pitch that you want on 0-2. It's a beautifully executed by Austin Edwards. Edwards, that's his sixth strikeout of the ball game. Josh Center stands in. He was one of those six strikeout victims back in the third. He also has a two-run single. That one's at the bottom of the strike zone. Umpson Crusader armor behind the plate didn't seem to agree with that one. Chops that one third base side. Again, another nice play by a third base coach. That's been a common theme today, both games. Oh, 2. See what Edwards comes with here. Does he go breaking ball or does he go fastball? He goes fastball. Misses downstairs, 2-2. He's trying to get his seventh strike out of the ball game, and he gets just that right there. Gets a swing and a miss on the curveball. Center's retired on strikes for the second time today. Here's Zach Zara. He had an RBI base hit in the first. And grounded out to first in the third. Seven strikeouts for Edwards this far in the ballgame through 4 2/3. First pitch to Zara. It's fouled back up to the net. The one inside nearly hits Zara and goes all the way to the backstop. And Clarendon was set up on the outside part of the plate, and that ball came with some pepper on it the inside. Clarendon couldn't quite corral that one. Here's the 1-1. Breaking ball definitely didn't get on top of that one. 2-1. Lenoir-Rhyne in desperate need of a shutdown inning to try to get their offense back in the dugout. Try to chip away at this North Greenville lead. 2-1's way outside, 3-1. Friendly count here for Zara. Does he get a fastball? I mean, there's been times where they've gotten curveballs. Let's see. It comes with a fastball. It's cued down the third base line, but foul. Miller's definitely shown that they're not afraid to throw a breaking ball, especially on 3-1. Here's the payoff pitch. He's got a piece of that one to stay alive. If Zara were to reach, Campbell Connor would be next. Here's the 3-2 once more. And we'll do it. That's fouls. We'll do it again. Good battle going here between Zara and Edwards. Eighth pitch of the at-bat upcoming. And it's just outside, ball four. Good, great at-bat for Zach Zara as he works a two-out walk. And indeed, we'll bring up the catcher, Campbell Connard. Connard's 1-for-2 on the day. He struck out swinging to end the first, and then he singled in the third. In fact, that actually drove in Marek Kloop. That was the fifth and so far last Crusader run. First pitch fastball misses up and away. Story with Connard now, of course, catchered. Go to a place where John Michael fail, you know, you're not going to get much playing time. And kind of late in the season, he's been a nice addition to this order. We're in just a second. Here's the 1-0. Breaking ball. Didn't get on top of that one. Yeah, John Michael fail got injured in the first round game against King in the conference tournament up in Wilson, North Carolina. We're going to get a mound visit. Yeah, he got inserted into the lineup. It had to come play immediately. And what does he do in his first at bat? Well, he takes one out to right field for his first career home run. So, kid's been kind of thrusted into the lineup, only a freshman. Fielded nicely behind the plate to go along with Jax Cash as well. So after another delay, appears we're finally ready for Edwards to make the 2-0 pitch. Here's the 2-0. Came inside, missed inside. 3-0. Bryce Roddy, the DH, waits on deck. The 3-0. Taking all the way is Connor, 3-1. And still looking for that one pitch, one spot. Old cliche that coaches use. So true, though. Zara takes off for second as pitch is lined down the right field line and into the bullpen for LR. Zara will have to retreat. He was running with 3-1 pitch. Now the count full with two outs, he'll be most definitely off with the pitch. Big spot here, Edwards versus Connor. The payoff. Breaking ball, first base side, and foul. Do it again. Back-to-back long at-bats for Austin Edwards. Already over the 100 pitch mark already here in the top of the fifth. Before he throws the next one, we'll have another time call. Trying to extend the inning. Edwards looking for his eighth strikeout. The pitch. Hit high in the air to right. Right back. Now coming in is Bell, camping under it. He's got it, and that will retire the side. A two-out walk issue to Zara, but he can't advance any further. We're halfway home in this one. North Greenville out in front, 5-2. Eight, 9-1 due up for the Bears here in the bottom of the fifth. And halfway through this one, Farts 5 runs, 8 hits, 1 error for the Crusaders. 2 runs on 4 hits, 2 errors for the Bears of LR. Bryce Stober, Eric Ramirez, and then back to the top of the order for David Bell. Notagus out there for his fifth inning of work. First pitch, we'd probably like to have that one back as that one skips up there. Here's the 1-0. That one's hit right at Octavio. Stober's 0-2. Here's Eric Ramirez. Eric Ramirez is 0-1. He grounded out to short in his lone plate appearance in the third. Carl, two runs, four hits for Takis. In his most important start of the year for as a Crusader. Quick pitches Ramirez, pumps a fastball by him, 0-1. Getting ahead of the count is so important for both pitchers today. When they've done that, they've been very successful. That one's hit out to center field. Center going back now, stopping as he makes the catch. Two away. It's two up, two down here for LR in the bottom of the fifth. Kick things back to the top of the order for David Bell. 0-2 officially. Flew out to left and then reached on an E5. And his third time through the order for LR. They definitely had better swings the second time through the order than they did the first time, with the exception of Anthony Perino. Another quick pitch, and it's a good one, 0-2. Yo, two from Takis skips up there. Again, only 58 pitches thus far for Noah. Opposed to his counterpart, Austin Edwards, he's kind of had to labor a little bit more. He's at 109 pitches through five innings. Here's the 1-2. Just got a piece of that one. Connor couldn't quite hold on to that one. Count remains 1-2. Ready, the 1-2, quick pitch, and it up and in, it hits Bell, and he'll reach first with two down. Here's the second baseman, Cole Laskowski. Laskowski 0-2. Lined out to the third baseman, and then struck out swinging in the third. He's one of two strikeouts so far on the day for Noah Takis. Drops that one foul. Since starting to make its way. It's going to be maybe a little bit of a problem for hitters as we get further into tonight. As a breaking ball doesn't break quite enough. Count even at 1-1. Fastball looked good, didn't get the call on the inside corner. 2-1. M- made the motion that it was too far in. Two-one Brigham misses outside, 3-1. He's retired the first two guys in order. Had Bell with two strikes on him, came up and in and hit him with a fastball. Now he's got Laskowski in a 3-1 count. There's one right down the middle, 3-2. Two outs. The runner Bell over at first will be off with the pitch. The payoff pitch. Missed inside. Ball four. Trent continues for Laskowski. That's the sixth time he's reached base in the regional. Still has yet to record a hit, though. But he's doing a great job of getting on base. Been hit three times. He's also walked three times. We're going to get a mound visit. Score update. Belmont Abbey out in front of Young Harrison. That elimination game over there in Wingate, North Carolina. Up 5-2 going to the bottom of the ninth. Bowman have a sixth seed over there. Young Harris is 7. It's interesting because Young Harris has had a successful postseason run up to this point. They won the Peach Belt tournament, knocking off the regular season champion Columbus State, who's ranked in the top 10 in most polls for Division II baseball. And they came into a regional as hot as a firecracker. But 9-4 loss to Wingate yesterday, and now they're down to their final two outs as well, actually. Two outs away from their season being over. So here's Drew Yanesta. North Greenville's got to scare you because this guy definitely has got the power to leave the yard. In fact, same scenario. It was 5-2 yesterday in the game against Pembroke when he went yard with a 3-run homer. And two-out trouble for Takis. Largely his doing. Got the first two guys out in the inning, then a hit by pitch, and then a walk issue to Laskowski. On the ground, third base side, nice diving stop by Pat Monteith. Throw across the diamond, low throw, he's safe. Monteith thought he had him. It was a bang-bang play. But Bobby Dunnigan over there at first made the call and said he was emphatically safe. Take another look at that one. Hustling all the way was Yanesta. Oh, man. Unless there's something there that I don't see, that throw appeared to have beaten him by a mile. And I can understand why Monteith was a little bit upset with that one. So the bases are loaded for Nick Clarno. One of those times if you're North Greenville, you kind of wish there was a video review. First pitch to him's downstairs. That was great camera work by our crew. These guys have been excellent all week and giving us all the best angles. You guys have been doing fantastic work out there for sure. Count it 1-0. Hit the right field. Klup dives. He caught it. Klup saves two runs with a headfirst dive. What a catch. I thought for sure that was going to get down. But Klup said, not on my watch. What a play. We got to have a replay of that one. Floop saves a couple runs, and here we go. Here's the replay. Get there eventually. Again, thought for sure Clarino had at least driven in two runs with that one. Kloop head first dive, and he's excited. I understand why. That beautiful play from Marek Kloop in front of his dad, in front of his family from the Czech Republic. Unbelievable. What a play, and what a way to send us to the sixth inning. Marek Kloop with at least a two-run saving catch to end the bottom of the fifth inning. It'll be 8-9-1 duo for the Crusaders. It'll be Roddy, Bivens, and then Octavio. First pitch is pumped in there for a called strike one. It was almost kind of like justice serve, because play before, Monteith made an excellent play, diving to his left. Appeared to have Yanesta thrown out, but questionable call, as that one's way outside. By the way, there's a new pitcher for the Bears. It'll be Kanan Butler. As Austin Edwards' day is done after five innings, throwing 109 pitches, five runs on eight hits. Here's the 1-1. It's hit up the middle. Skowski to his right. Backhand throw play on over to first is in time. Just take a look at that one. It beat him by less than half a step. Close play, but right call. Here's Corey Bivens, 1-for-2. His one hit was a loud one, though, as he launched his 11th home run of the year. First pitch breaking ball from Butler. Butler, graduate student out of Cary, North Carolina. Place where both these teams are trying to get to. Here's the 0-1. Out slapped in the right field. That's going to get down for a base hit in front of Bell. That's Bibb's second hit of the day. Now get things back to the top of the order for Garrett Octavio.
And now batting for the Crusaders, number one, Dillard.
Tavio's 1-for-3. His base hit coming in the second. In fact, that was his first hit of the regional. Check on Bivens over at first. Bivens can run. Doesn't do it a lot, but doesn't do it a little. He's 10-for-14 in that department this year. I would be surprised to see him take off here, though. I'll skip that. That's going to get by. Clarendon go all the way to the backstop. He made so many nice stops this weekend so far, and that one was just too hot to handle. As Bivens is now in scoring position. Butler definitely throws hard, so sometimes just gets away from you. Here's the 1-0. That's off the outside corner, 2-0. Hitter friendly count here for Octavio. Has some room in the 5-6 hole if he elects to go that way. Here's the 2-0. That's called a strike on the outside corner. Waits a 2-1. Some of the people were clamoring for it to be a balk, but didn't quite get the call. He was kind of stuttering a little bit, but I don't think it was enough to be a balk. Here's the 2-1 from Butler. That one's low and away. 3-1. Stringer's on deck. Stringer's 2-for-3 on the day, so a good scenario if he can come on with two runners on. Here's the 3-1 from Butler. Had to go with a slider, backdoor slider. So that'll run it full. I'm saying the LR pitching staff definitely not afraid to throw a breaking ball at any count. See if he comes with that again, or does he try to challenge him with a fastball? The payoff pitch. Tried to challenge him with a fastball, and Octavio spoiled it. Count remains full. Yeah, left fielder and center fielder playing Octavio very shallow. Right fielder playing a little deep. See if he can drop one in the right field. And they call it a balk. People were calling for a balk a couple pitches ago. They finally get one there, so that'll move Bivens over to third. Second base umpire Casey Smith made the call. So the count's full now with a runner on third. Now LR will bring the infield in. Third base, at least on the right side. Shortstop comes in a little bit, not all the way. Here's the payoff pitch. Tavio spoils that one. Good battle going here between Butler and Octavio. Butler likes his slider. Maybe see if he can try to come with that breaking ball right here. Here's the pitch. Came with it, and Octavio hits it out to right center field. They're not going to get it. Octavio on his way to second. That's the reason why they call him the Flying Hawaiian, as he flies into second base with an RBI double. And North Greenville leads it 6-2. Big insurance runs for the Crusaders. There's some action out there in the LR bullpen. Gonna get a visit to the mound here. Kind of settle him down, because again, the action in the bullpen isn't too serious. They're not even throwing off the mound quite yet. They're just kind of tossing, getting loose. I don't expect a pitching change here. That was a very, very brief conversation right there. Usually those are the ones as pitchers you always hated when they're brief, because it's usually to the point. Hey, get it together, let's go. That was a very brief mound visit from Derek Beasley. There's the action in the bullpen I was talking about just a moment ago. As the southpaw warms up. So a run in off the Octavio double. Now Ethan Stringer is 2-for-3 on the day. It's to him, he's hacking away, fouls it back. And North Greenville has to win this game to stay alive. If Lenoir-Rhyne wins, they will advance to the Super Regionals next weekend. North Greenville wins, they'll force a winner-take-all game tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock. Here's the 0-1. Good fastball on the outer half, knee high. Beller way ahead of Stringer, 0-2. With a breaking ball, Ethan will chop it foul. Six runs on 10 hits now for the Crusaders. Two runs on 5 hits for the Bears. Count remains 0-2. Here's the pitch. Laced down the left field line, but it's foul. Stringer waited about as long as he could on that breaking ball. Definitely a difference in speed there from Caden Butler. Couldn't quite keep it fair. The 0-2 once more. And with a fastball just off the plate. Good plate discipline from Stringer right there. I'll look in. Here's the 1-2. That's low and away as well. 2-2. North Greenville team that's been NCAA Regional and for Division II 5 times now. The first 4 times they've not made it to carry. They're trying to change that this year. Lenoir-Rhyne kind of burst on the scene this year with their now 46-11. Two heavyweight teams as Octavio takes off for third, pitches inside, throw down to third, gets away. Octavio's going to try to go home. He will be safe no matter what because of the runner's interference, and it's 7-2. For Octavio, that's his 20th stolen base of the year. And he'll take home on the E2. That's the third error of the ballgame for the Bears. Now the bases are empty. And it's a full count to Ethan Stringer. Sometimes aggressive base running can pay off for you. As Stringer lines that one down the left field line. And it will go foul. Look at that play over at third. Kind of got away. Look at this right here. That's good heads up base right there. He knows that he's got the lane, and he knows that Eric Ramirez over there at third is kind of in his way there, and it's nothing Ramirez can do. The throw kind of took him into the base path, but it's a heads up play by Octavio. Here's the 3-2. Inside, it hit him. It's one of those when you're hit by a full count, you're just like, man, couldn't it just missed? But either way, Ethan Stringer is on base. Here's Pat Monteith. Monteith had a good day yesterday, went 4-for-5 with 2 home runs. Went 0-4 in game 1, and he's 0-for-3 so far here in game 2 today. Takes the first pitch fastball and misses upstairs, 1-0. North Greenville offense, you know what the opposition in the other dugout's capable of. So if you're North Greenville, you're trying to tack on as many runs as you can. Check on Stringer. And obviously you saw what they did to Pembroke yesterday, scoring 11 unanswered runs to finish the ball game. One of those pumped in there. For the Bears, in the bottom of the inning, they'll have Atiles Perino and then Ethan Smith. They'll be looking ahead to the bottom half of the sixth. 1-1 as Stringer takes off for second. Crusaders had the hit and run on as that's fouled away. Stringer doesn't run a ton. He's only tried 11 times. He's been a successful 9. Counts at 1-2. Breaking ball popped up. On the infield going out is Laskowski. He's going to give way to the right fielder Bell, and he'll make the grab. 2 away. Here's North Greenville cleanup hitter, Marek Kloop. Kloop's 1-for-2 on the day. Singled in the first. Struck out in the fifth, and he's also reached and scored after walking. Kloop with the injury to John Michael Fale is the currently only member in the lineup, batting over 400. First pitch to him. Breaking ball in there for strike. As of right now, Kloop's coming in at 420. To him is hit out to left field. He got it off the end of the bat. Stoper started back, now coming in, makes the grab to retire the side, but not before the Crusaders pick up 2 runs on 2 hits. We head to the bottom of the sixth, 7-2, North Greenville.
Sorry that my time is up, but I can't go on.
Teles, Perino, and then Smith to follow. It'll be Stober and then Ramirez after them if we get to them. Teles has grounded out twice, including into a six unassisted, three double play. It was a nice shifty footwork by the North Greenville shortstop, Corey Bivens. Tag is still out there for North Greenville. It's his first pitch pumped in there on the inside corner, strike one. Yo, one up and in. Here's the 1-1. That's fouled off of Tillis' foot. 1-2. Game one today definitely went by fast. Briskly played. You know, good pitching on both sides up until latter half of the game. Got it in under 3 hours. Here's the 1-2. Skips up there. This one not being played quite as fast. Bottom of six here, and the game's about 2 hours and 16 minutes old. Two-two Braveball doesn't quite get the call. So that'll run it full. Payoff pitch from Takis. Yeah. On the chase, a breaking ball for the first out of the inning. For Takis, that's just his third strikeout of the ball game. Here's Anthony Perino. And no matter the first, second, or third time through the order, it doesn't matter for Perino. He's got two of the five LR hits. He took Takis deep out to right center field in the second inning. First base runner that LR had. He also had a ground rule double that was responsible for the other RBI in the fourth. Want to know? Yeah, it's interesting. You see guys like, you know, the Johnny Cueto, like, kind of rubbing off on these younger guys. Noah Takis kind of doing his little abbreviation. Does a little normal one there as that one's sent out to right field. Ball carries well here. Kloop at the wall. Just shy of the wall. Makes the grab for out number two. Perino almost sent another one out that way. Comes just a couple feet shy. So here's Ethan Smith. The finish that thought, you know, Takis loves the quick pitch. You know, he'll mix it up every once in a while when he's in the windup, obviously. Now, I saw the other night, sometimes it could kind of backfire on you. First pitch shows bunt, pulls it back to Ethan Smith. I don't know if some of you may have seen the clip, but I was watching a Division I baseball game. It was Oklahoma State and Texas Tech. There's a guy for Texas Tech that quit pitch the Oklahoma State guy, and he made him pay for it, to say the least. Took him out to left field 513 feet. Yes, you heard that correctly. Some of you probably maybe have seen it. So there's definitely positives to quick pitching. You know, sometimes it can also bite you in the rear end. As three straight out of the zone to Ethan Smith. The Crusaders have the shift on for Ethan. Monteith, only one left side. He's all the way, he's even with the bag on the third baseline. Now creeping in as that one's pumped there in there for strike one. Getting a look at number 10, Corey Bivens. He's the shortstop, believe it or not. Zara's about four steps off the line. Tavio's in short right center field. 3-1. He did show bunt as Mont, and he's going to get a base hit out of it. So the moment Monteith, who was playing even with the bag normal depth, moves kind of over towards shortstop, and Ethan Smith goes, oh, there's my opportunity. So he lays down a perfect bunt. It's his first hit and the sixth hit for the Bears. Stober shows bunt. That's a rare feat you don't see too often. Someone bunting a foul ball over the net behind the plate. Exactly what Stober did. Even after the bunt, Pat Monteith still kind of playing about three or four steps behind the third base bag. Interesting to see if they try to bunt again. They do. It's behind him. It's actually clipped him on the way by, did Stober. So that put runners at first and second. They're going to claim Landon Powell's going to make his case for the fact that it hit the bat. So the umpire said, no, it clipped him in the shoulder. Let's take a look here. For me, that kind of looked like it hit the shoulder. It was tough to tell. Maybe it glanced the bat after the way by, but I think that was the being the appropriate call. Now, I have to see it a little bit slower, but first reaction, seeing the replay at full speed, it definitely appeared that it looked like it got his shoulder before. Here we go. I don't know. To me, that looks like it hits the shoulder. I could be wrong, but maybe it's something I'm not seeing. They're going to call the umpires together, actually. You know, it's kind of tough to tell from that angle as well. I mean, that's a really good shot we have there. Still kind of tough to tell. All four members of the four umpire crew coming together. I mean, no one's going to have a better call or better angle than that one than Kevin Spivey behind the plate. So I don't know. I don't think we're going to get much of a overturn here. And they're going to indeed reward him first base. From where I am, it's kind of hard. Sometimes you hear the sound, sometimes you don't. You know, I couldn't hear that metal sound, so to me it was surprising. But nonetheless, runners at first and second for the Braves. Here it's Eric Ramirez. Getting a little two-out trouble here for Takis. Ramirez had a big swing at that one. Kind of thinking fastball there, and Takis brought a first pitch breaking ball. Second straight inning that Takis has had a little bit of two-out trouble. Last inning, he got the first two guys out. I think went back to the top of the order with two strikes. He hit a batter and then had a walk and then a single. For ultimately getting a nice diving play by Kloop out there in right, as Ramirez will foul that one off his foot. That did not look like it felt good. See, where did that get him? Take a look at the replay. Got a little off the foot. Not too bad, you know. Didn't look it appeared to hit the ankle. Doesn't mean it doesn't hurt any less. Attack is way ahead. 0-2 of Ramirez. Time call. Tagus like to come right after Ramirez or try to go with a breaking ball. Pierce Cotter and Tagus can't get on the same wavelength, so they're going to go out and chat about it. While we have this time, I just want to mention, earlier we were talking about Belmont Abbey had a 5-2 lead going into the bottom of the ninth inning against Young Harris. Well, Young Harris, they came back, and including a walk-off two-run home run as they knock off Belmont Abbey and they eliminate Belmont Abbey. So as of right now, North Greenville is the final conference. Carolina's a team left in the field. Here's the 0-2. Hit on the ground to short. Bivens will let it go a long way over to first, and he gets the out there. A little two-out trouble for the Bears in the bottom of the sixth, but they can't bring anyone across. We played six. We head to the seventh. North Greenville. It'll be 5, 6, and 7 for the Crusaders. Center Azara and Connard. They'll be facing a new pitcher for Lenoir-Rhyne. Get a look at Josh Center right there. Center, 1-for-3 on day, 2-run base hit, and then his next two times he struck out looking and then struck out swinging. As a new pitcher is Caleb Cockerham, freshman from Clemens, North Carolina, West Forsyth High School. Southpaw delivers to center. First pitch called strike. Here's the 0-1. A big old sweeping breaking ball. Didn't catch the zone. One ones on the outside corner, 1-2. Center one strike away from the hat trick that's never good in baseball. The three strikeout game has been a problem for him lately. Is the 1-2. Skips up there, 2-2. Here's the 2-2. A fastball on the outside corner. Or at least Clarino thought so. Instead, it's a full count. Count full to center. Pitch from Cockerham. Jam shot over to third. Come Ramirez. Run. Oh, they're actually going to call a foul ball. They must have hit Josh. I didn't look like him. Don't know if we got a good angle for that replay. I mean, from my angle, it was tough to tell. It didn't look like it did, but. Huh. Interesting. And 7 runs on 10 hits for the Crusaders, 1 error. 2 runs on 6 hits, 3 errors for the Bears. Center's chat with Landon Powell is over. Cockerham ready in the payoff pitch. Jam shot, that's going to get out of play. Do it again. Strikeouts have been a problem for center this year. He leaves the team with 61 of them coming into today. He's got 2 more to add to that total as well. Here's the 3-2. That one skips up there, and he earns a well-earned walk. Center on first, here's Zach Zara. Lefty on lefty matchup here. First pitch swing, come up empty. Zara's 1-for-2 officially. He singled in the first. He's also reached on a walk in the fifth. Here's the 0-1. Sorry, showed bunt but pulled it back to take a ball. In a game North Greenville's got to have. For the 1-1, we'll have a check on center over there at first. A little low throw, but handled by Perino. Center takes off for second. Throw down to second. Will be late. Center, that's his 23rd stolen bag of the year. Trying to keep up with his teammate, Kloop, who had his 26th of the year earlier in the ballgame. So now a runner in scoring position for Zara. Now it's a 1-2 count. And a little bit of a hole on the right side. As until Laskowski gets back over that way. That one's fouled out of play. Plenty of pitches for Cockrum to work with here. Looks like he's going to try to go on the outside part of the plate. Here's the 1-2. And with the breaking ball, stayed high. Count even 2-2. For LR, this is the first game of the regional, third official game. First time that they've had to use more than two pitchers. Here's the 2-2. One's at the end of the bat in the center field. Smith now coming in. We'll make to Graham.
That's going to bring up number 17, Campbell Connard.
So here's Campbell Connard. Switch hitting catcher. First time I've gotten to see him hit right-hander with a lefty on the mound. Connor's 1-for-3 on the day. His base hit coming in the third. That one's low. For the 1-0, Cockrum will check on center, try to keep him close. Again, we're itching closer and closer to that potential daunted sun delay. I think we can play for a couple more innings. I don't know if that sun's going to become a factor or not here shortly, as that one misses downstairs. Never forget the first time I was calling a game for NG Baseball. It was 2019. And they stopped playing. They just kind of stopped everything. We were broadcasting out there in right center before this broadcast booth was built. And I'm like, yep, this is a sun delay. I'm like, it's a sun what? Apparently that's the thing around here. Here's the 2-0. That's a knee-high strike. For those LR fans tuning in, just so you know, sometimes the sun, like at this time of year, will set right over in the kind of where the batter's eye vision would be, so they kind of delay things for about half an hour to kind of give the sun time to set, make things playable again. Could happen. Here's the 2-1. That's low and in. Three-one count, looking for that one pitch, that one spot here. 3-1, challenged them with a fastball, came up empty, count full. Obviously for LR, you can't afford any more runs to cross. Already got your hands full down by five here in the final third of this ball game. Here's the payoff pitch. It's a beautiful fastball on the outside corner. Strike three. That's the first strikeout for Cockrum. As he catches Connard looking, he's down on strikes for the second time today. Here's the DH Excuse me, we're actually going to get a looks like we're going to get a pitch hitter here. I believe this is Andrew Kaminsky. Right in that. So Andrew Kaminsky grabs a bat for his first at bat today and for the regional. Kaminsky 286 on the year. One home run, six runs batted in as he takes a first pitch strike. That one home run came on senior day in game one of the doubleheader against Emmanuel about a month ago. Here's the 0-1. Bergwell didn't quite break enough, 1-1. Comes with here on the 1-1 with a break. Well, that's ripped in the left center field. That's going to get down for a base hit. Center around third. He's going to score easily. And Kaminsky comes through with an RBI base hit. It's 8-2 North Greenville. So Kaminsky makes Landon Powell look like a genius right there. As Crusaders pick up their eighth run and their 11th hit. So here's Corey Bivens. Bivens is 2-for-3 on the day. It is 11th home run of the year in the second inning. Shoots that one out towards second. Should be an easy play for Laskowski, and it is. And that will retire the side. But not before North Greenville picks up a run on the RBI single by pitch hitter Andrew Kaminsky. Time to stretch here in Tigerville. North Greenville on top, 8-2. Top of the order due up for the Bears. It'll be Bell, Laskowski, and Iniesta. Tag is still out there for North Greenville as he begins his seventh inning of work. Begins the inning with 88 pitches. Landon Powell riding Tackett as long as he possibly can. So if he can get him and go a few more innings and save some arms for the bullpen. That's a good pitch. Cut on, missed by Bell. Kind of save his arms and have a full complementary of arms for a potential winner-take-all game three tomorrow afternoon. Here's the 0-1. Breaking ball caught the inside corner, 0-2. That gets, to this point, he's gone six-plus innings. Two runs on six hits. Mike County has struck out three. Counts at 1-2. Bell's 0-2 officially. He's flown out. He's reached on an error, and he was hit by a pitch. It's a quick pitch. Attackus thought he had Bell rung up. Again, that's multiple times now that that pitch has not been called a strike both ways. County event at 2-2. Two two, blows a fastball right by him. That's the fourth strikeout for Tackus. So here's Cole Laskowski. Cole's 0-2. He was reached on a walk in the fifth. And despite not having a hit in a regional, Laskowski's been an on-base machine. He puts a bunt there, but it's right back to Tackus. Have to get rid of it quick because Laskowski runs fast. And they're able to retire him over at first. But he's been an on-base machine for the Bears. He's been on six times, even though he hadn't gotten a hit yet. But he's retired here in the seventh. Took a second for Tackus to get that out of his glove, but he eventually got it over to first. So here's Drew Yanesta. 2-for-3 on the day. Singles in the fourth and the fifth. This is definitely by far the most pitches that Noah Tackus has thrown this season. As he's approaching the century mark. First pitch to Yanesta is taken high. There's the 1-0, a little quick pinch, but it's out high. Had a healthy hack at the 2-0, expecting a fastball. He got a breaking ball, 2-1. Come with here's the 2-1 is another sharp breaking ball. And a swung over the top of that one. Count even at 2-2. And only if Yanesta's number was number 22, because we'd have literally twos across the board. As there's two balls, two strikes, two outs. Here's the 2-2. That's on the inside corner, strike three. Tackus strikes out two of the three hitters he faces in the seventh inning. He's through seven with just under the
Crusaders, number one, Gary Octavio.
Top of the order, due up for the Crusaders here in the top half of the eighth inning. With Greenville on top 8-2, thanks in large part to 11 hits. They've also been helped up by three LR errors. Tavio's 2-for-4 on the day. His hits coming in the second and the sixth. Here's the first pitch to Octavia. That's right there, thigh high, 0-1. Yo, 1. Looked a little off the plate, but he got the call. Count it 0-2. Catcher setting way outside. Hits a spot. Tavia doesn't bite. One of those. Clarino was just kind of setting up outside there to try to see if they can get Tavia to chase one, knowing that the umpire was giving that call. Wanted to see just how far off the plate they could get. Here's the 1-2. They sliced that one. Oh, third base coach made a couple of nice plays. Had an opportunity to field that one, pick that one out of the air. He fumbled the bag on that one. Counts 1-2. Give him some slack. He's made some nice plays this weekend. Here's the 1-2. All right, just got a piece of that one, and it also got a piece of home plate umpire Bobby Dunnigan. In fact, Nat knocked his mask off. I'm going to come and check on him. Kind of sideswiped him a little bit. Looks like he's going to be okay. He's coherent and stuff, so I think he'll be all right. Here's that Dunnigan's going to be okay. He's a warrior back behind the plate there. So staying in there. Bobby Dunnigan behind the plate. Count still 1-2. Got in the chase a high pitch fastball with that one as Octavio's retired. He's most likely going to finish 2-for-5 on the day. Pitch to Stringer's foul straight back to the net. Again, here's the 0-1. That's hit back up the middle. That's going to get through for a base hit. Stringer, that's his third single of the afternoon. After going quiet in the first two games of the regional. Breaks out with a three-hit game. So here's Pat Monteith. Stringer takes off for second as the pitch is inside. It's actually going to go all the way to the backstop. Stringer, I'm not sure, was aware, never looked, but I don't think it would have mattered anyway. So that's his second stolen base of the game. Single by Stringer, the 12th hit for the Crusaders. One zero is a breaking ball, misses down low. Tagus, I wouldn't be surprised to see him come back out for North Greenville. He is currently standing at 99 pitches. Considering the fact that we saw pitch for Lenoir-Rhyne, Lanham, is that one's low and away, 3-0. Go 134 pitches yesterday, and I think anything is possible. Of course, Tagus has been at times, or early in the season, was on a pitch count. Obviously, at 99 pitches, he's no longer on said pitch count. Let's just see if Monteith has the green light here. Here's the 3-0, taking all the way, 3-1. Klupa waits on deck. He's 1-for-3. He's also scored a run. One's at the knees. That'll run it full. So 3-0 to 3-2. Payoff pitch. Ball four outside. So another walk for the Crusaders. Puts runners at first and second for Marek Loop. Market Jr. from the Czech Republic. Made his way to Tigerville a couple years ago. It's the first pitch breaking ball. Fooled him. Foot comes set. Here's his 0-1. Challenged Mark with a fastball, and he fouled it away. Florida quickly ahead of Kloop, 0-2. He can go back to any pitch that he would like here. I'd be expecting, if I'm Kloop, the breaking ball. So maybe, with that said, he might challenge him with a fastball here. Let's see. Here's the 0-2. Well, before that, we're going to check on Stringer at second. And barring a massive comeback from the Bears at their final 6 outs, we do have plenty of time left. If this current results hold, we will have a game 3 tomorrow. Here's the 0-2. Gets away from the catcher, and that's going to allow both runners to advance 90 feet. And I hope I didn't jinx Clarino, you know, old broadcaster's jinx. You know, there are so many times where he's had some nice stops behind the plate, but here recently some balls are starting to squirt away. So now a base hit could score two here. corner is now playing even with the bag for the Bears. Middle infielder still back as the breaking ball to Kloop catches the outside corner, and he's caught looking. As Kloop goes down on strikes for the second time today, he's not too fond of that call, but it was a good pitch. So here's Josh Center. One for three. Single in the first, and then walked his last plate appearance in the seventh. So runs the second, third, but now two away. Here's a first pitch fastball right down Tigerville Boulevard, 0-1. The 0-1 pumps another fastball. This one's a little too far outside. I'm looking for Floyd. Here's the 1-1. That's going to miss downstairs. Center heading to count 2-1. Wind has definitely picked up. Still blowing left to right, but it's definitely picked up. So keep that in mind for any kind of fly ball hit out to left field. It could potentially kill it, or anything out to right could drift it more towards the line. 2-1, that misses as well, 3-1. What does Floyd come with right here? Here's the 3-1 with a fastball, and Center got one he could hit, but he would like to have that one back. The count runs full. Full count awaits. The pitch. Center spoiled it. Seventh pitch of the at-bat upcoming. And a base hit here would almost surely put the dagger. Here's 3-2. In with a breaking ball and got Center to chase for out number three. Mr. Floyd comes in. Besides a single and a walk, he strikes out the side. We'll head to the bottom of the eighth. Six outs left for the Bears. Try to erase this six-run deficit. Part of the order, do it for the Bears. It'll be Clarino, Atiles, and then Porino. Tag is still out there for North Greenville as first pitch swing in, high fly ball on the right. Klub tracking at the wall, just shy of the wall, makes the grab. So a deep fly ball out for Clarino, one away. Not for a second, the way the ball travels out the right field, that had a good chance to get out of here. Clarino just comes up just short. So here's Luis Atiles. Tails is 0 for 3, grounded out twice, including into a double play, and he's also struck out. Takes the first pitch high. Takis at the 101 pitch mark now, about to deliver 102nd pitch, and that one might have been a strike if we're playing cricket, but not here. Hit a friendly count here for Tails. And the back with a beautiful breaking ball that time, 2-1. Here's a 2-1. Jam shot, that'll get out of play, even to count up at 2-2. Eight runs on 12 hits, one error for the Crusaders of North Greenville. Two runs, six hits, three errors for the Bears of Lenoir-Rhyne. A little bit different hitting display from the Crusaders. Only managed five hits in game number one earlier today. That one's chopped on the ground to third. Monteith with it. Good throw gets him, and it is two away. They only had five hits in game one earlier today. In fact, I think they had, if I'm not mistaken, they had that by like the second inning. Yes, they had five hits through the first two innings today in game number two. Here's Perino. Perino's 2 for 3, a home run to right center field. That was a clear defense by a good, let's say, 20 to 25 feet out there. Had a double and then had a deep fly out to right, just shy of the wall. So he's made some solid contact off Takis as he faces him for the fourth time today. There's the 0-1. That one got away from Takis. The 1-1. Got that one by him, 1-2. Takis before today, his longest outing was seven innings against Mount Olive in the conference championship. He's surpassed that here today, already with 7 2/3. He's one strike away from sending us to the top of the ninth. Here's the 1-2. Popped up, foul side down the right field line. Zara and Klup giving chase, but it's out of reach. Count remains 1-2. Tag is set for his 110th pitch of the ball game. Here it is. Cut on and miss. Strike three. Takis, eight beautiful innings for the Crusaders when they needed it most. We go to the ninth. North Greenville on top, 8-2. Go to the top half of the ninth inning. North Greenville leading 8-2. There's a new pitcher on the mound for Lenoir-Rhyne. Number 10, Chipper McGinnis, redshirt sophomore out of Ellenboro, North Carolina, Chase High School. Southpaw gets some work in. Try to keep things right where they're at. Score update going on. Top half of the first inning, Columbus State and Wingate. Columbus State's actually grabbed a 2-0 lead. Again, Robert Brooks broke the Peach Belt record for home runs in a career with 64 yesterday. He just hit his 65th, which has given Columbus State a 2-0 lead. They're still in the top half of the first inning. 2-0 lead over Wingate, that is. Loser of that one will play Young Harris, who had an improbable come-from-behind win against Belmont Abbey earlier in the day. Again, the winner of that regional versus the winner of this regional, which at this point will be either North Greenville or Lenoir-Rhyne. Here's Zach Zara. He's 1-for-3 on the day. An RBI single in the first. Then walked in the fifth. Oh, one leaves that one outside. Count even at 1-1. Yeah, if results hold like this for the final three outs in the bottom of this inning, North Greenville and Lenoir-Rhyne will meet again tomorrow. Yeah, Zaro slapped that one out of play. For a winner-take-all game three, that is if Lenoir-Rhyne does not score at least six runs in the bottom of this inning, maybe even more, depends on what this top of the ninth brings. Here's the 1-2. I'm going to poke that out to second. Good throw over to first in time, one away. So here's catcher Campbell Connard. First pitch from McGinnis is in there for breaking ball, strike one. Owen Connor pulls that one down the left field line, giving chase to Stober, but he's going to run out of room. It's going to be interesting to hear from head coach Landon Powell and talk about what he might do at catcher tomorrow. Will he bring Cash back, or will he leave Connard in there? Here's the 0-2. That's off the plate. My expectations, he's going to put Cash back in there. He just didn't want to use him in the nightcap after he caught all 9 innings of game 1 early today. Count even at 2-2. There's a 2-2 from McGinnis. Stays alive. Look ahead to the bottom of the ninth. The Bears will have the bottom third of the order. It'll be Smith, Stober, and then Ramirez. Another thing post-game to find out from head coach Chris Ramirez over at Lenoir-Rhyne will be the status of Wade Kuda, as that one's on the ground to third. Across the diamond in time, 2 away. So 2-2, 2 down for McGinnis here in the top of the ninth. He'll face Andrew Kaminsky. Kaminsky came on in place of Bryce Rodney as he had a pitch hit. In the seventh inning, it was an RBI base hit to left center as he hits that one to right center field. And on the run is Smith. He will make the grab for the third and final out. So North Greenville goes 1-2-3 in the ninth. Final call for the Bears in the bottom half of the ninth. Final call for the Bears here in the home half of the ninth. Noah Takisday is done after 8 innings of 2-run, 6-hit ball. Mike County struck out 6 through those 8 innings. And he'll give way, final frame, to Nathan Barillette. Right-hander redshirt junior. Out of Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. As he finishes his warm-up tosses. I mentioned top of the ninth, it'll be Smith, Stober, and Ramirez for the Bears in the bottom half. And they need at least 6 runs to keep this one going. If they can't, we'll see you tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock. Of course, Ethan Smith, not in the original starting lineup, but replaced Wade Kuda, who kind of got bit by the turf monster out there in the top of the third inning. You saw on the replay, it didn't look great. He was able to finish the rest of the inning, but once he came in, his turn was due up to hit in the order. He was taken down immediately. From Barillette's. Right there, strike one. Smith is 1-for-3. His base hit was in the sixth is when he bunted against the shift. No one. The Barlett comes in pumping as that one's low and away. Here's the 1-1. That one about a 58-footer. Here's the 2-1. That looked good. That looked like it was on the outside corner, but call not given. Hitter friendly count here for Smith. There's a 3-1. That one's called. That'll run it full. So now with two strikes, the North Greenville Institute there. Shift that they put on for almost every left-hander, just about. To get a load of Corey Bivens on your screen right there as the pitch is sent out in the right center field. Klug going back, sliding, and he'll actually give way to Josh Center, who will make the grab. One away. That'll bring up left fielder Bryce Stober. Maybe we're going to get a pitch hitter. From Barlett is sent out of play. Pitch hitter is going to be Braden Collette, freshman from Evans, Georgia. Transfer from Georgia Southern. Barlett challenged him with a fastball there, and he won 0-2. Here's the 0-2. Break ball hit up the middle. It's going to be a tough play. Bivens slides to his left. Had trouble getting out of the glove, and it's going to cost him. A nice play by Bivens sliding to his left. But the slight bobble getting it out of the glove is going to allow the runner to reach. That's the seventh hit of the ball game for the Bears. So we're going to get a pinch hitter. Again, will be Ryan Healy, Richard Jr. from Charlotte, North Carolina, transfer from Catawba Valley Community College. He'll grab a bat in place of Eric Ramirez. He takes that first pitch and sends that one in the right center field gap. That one's going to go all the way to the wall. And waves the runner all the way around third. He will score, and it's 8-3. It's a good piece of hitting there from Ryan Healy. Just kind of took the pitch where it was pitched and just served it out in the right center field gap. Scoring on the play was Collette. Here's David Bell. Takes the first pitch breakable at the knees, strike one. He's hitless on the day. 0 for 3. He has reached base twice, once on an error, and another time as he was hit by a pitch. Two outs to get for North Greenville to try to stave off elimination. Here's the 0-1. Nice play there by Campbell to keep that in front of him. Count at 1-1. Charlie challenged him with a fastball. Bell fouled it back. Count at 1-2. Set. And it's 1-2. That one, Conrad couldn't quite block that one. Now a fourth LR runs, just stands just 90 feet away. Got the shift on for Bell. And if you ever wonder, the team that probably shifts the most is probably this North Greenville team. They believe in it heavy. As a 2-2 is sent out into the left center field, that's going to get down for a base hit. Bell's got his first hit of game number two today. And it's 8-4. So if anything, they're at least getting some momentum, trying to get some confidence, take something into game three tomorrow. Here's Laskowski. He's been an on-base machine. Reached base six times in the regional, but he has yet to get a hit. Still sails high. In a time when North Greenville really needed a strong start from a starting pitcher, at least to get some innings. No attack has really helped them out there. The 1-0 fastball misses off the plate. It's almost like LR's kind of eyes got big once attack has made his way off the bump. He's now responded with two runs on three hits. Remember I told you Columbus State had jumped out to a 2-0 lead? Well, the Wingate responded with very kindly with three of their own in the bottom half of the first, so they're now in the top half of the second. Pitching coach trying to kind of calm Barlett down. Say, hey, let him throw strikes. Come on. Like, not exactly what you wanted. So you got to be careful here because in the hole is Nick Clarino. He represents the what would be the tying run. He's in the hole. 3-0. That's right down Broadway. Lenoir-Rhyne trying to keep things alive here in North Greenville, trying to send things to tomorrow. Bell takes off for second, but he's have to retreat as that one's fouled away. So from 3-0 to 3-2. Here's 3-2. Bell takes off for second, but it's ball four. A little bit of a rally going here for the Bears. And the tying run is on deck. Here's Drew Yanesta. Yanesta's 2-for-4 on the day. His base hits coming in the fourth and fifth innings back-to-back. Given just a little bit of worry here in the ninth inning. Starting to escalate with every pitch. Lenoir-Rhyne came into the inning down by six. They've scored two. They're now within a grand slam possibility if they can get the bases loaded. Here's the 1-0. That's got to play right side. Sure what happened on the right side on the hills. There's a lot of people are looking up there. I can't tell from the booth. Will might be able to text me later. Here's the 1-1. That's out of play. 1-2. Down at 1-2. Allen served out in the right field. Klub coming on, makes the running grab. Two away. And now LR down their final out. Here's Nick Clairno. By the way, I have received confirmation that what people were looking up was the fact of there was a, and I quote, shattered one of the lights on the foul pole, one of the lights on the light pole. So I'm sure someone's going to have to fork over some money for that one. First pitch to Clairno. Bring broke too far, gets away from Connard, and everybody moves up 90 feet. Clairno's 1-for-4 on the day. His base hit in the fourth inning. His only hit. He's grounded out to second in the second. He's flew out to right in the fifth, and he's also flown out to right in the eighth. Here's the 1-0. At the knees, even the count at 1-1. Long look in here for Barrelet. Long time call. The 1-1. Howard on the ground is short. This could do it. Bivens over to first, and we will have a decisive game three tomorrow afternoon. Tally on this one. Game goes 3 hours and 32 minutes. Final tally, North Greenville, 8 runs, 12 hits, 1 error. Lenoir-Rhyne, 4 runs, 9 hits, 3 errors. Mentioned 3 hours and 32 minutes. So with that, North Greenville does indeed force a winner-take-all game 3 in this best-of-3 series between these two teams. Correction, I'm being told it's now noon. It's told 1 o'clock, now it's moved to noon. Apologize for that. All right. So never mind. Information was good upon arrival. So, again, game 3, nonetheless, will be at 1 o'clock tomorrow. I believe, unless we've changed our minds again. Kidding. Again, Noah Takis gets the win. Look here. And it'll be Austin Edwards that gets the loss. No save awarded. Again, 8 runs, 12 hits, 1 error for North Greenville, 4 runs on 9 hits, and 3 errors for the Bears. Look forward to tomorrow, but until then, I'm Timothy Holcomb, along with our production staff, Will Cahaley, Alan Cahaley, everybody involved, our wonderful camera operators out there. Thank you guys so much. We'll see you here tomorrow afternoon for the decisive Game 3, and we will see who gets to go to the Super Regionals tomorrow afternoon. Good night, everybody.